You all packed for your long trip?
I am. I just don't have enough room.
Well, Marty, is all of this really necessary? I mean, you've got a guitar, Legos, a lightsaber.
They are. They're not as important as the food or the water, but they are super important. Music, the arts, creature comforts, all of those help astronauts deal with being away from normal life, the psychology of long-term spaceflight. As a matter of fact, the lightsaber, guitar, and Legos have all flown into space before.
I think we're going to need a little time to talk about this.
We've got about 30 minutes.
This is STEM in 30. Aloha, I'm Beth.
And I'm Marty.
And we are coming to you live from the Smithsonian National Air and Space Museum in the Moving Beyond Earth Gallery, where it is Aloha Wednesday for STEM in 30.
We'd like to welcome our friends from Washington International School. Welcome, guys. We also have two friends with us here on stage. These are our student photojournalists today. They started this morning documenting their show from the time they got to school all the way through their trip to the museum and the show today. And you can see a couple of pictures that they have already taken today. And they are documenting every bit of their trip today. And we're going to share some of these out on our social media channels after the show today. And so they're taking all these pictures. Go ahead. All right, now you guys need to go get to work.
We also have several budding artists that are working on some masterpieces, and we will be checking in with them during the program today.
We want to remind you that you can ask questions. Yes, you, the kid in the back row in that desk, you can ask a question today.
All you have to do is go to our Facebook Live page and put your question in the comment section, and we might even take it live on the air.
So, Beth, what's with the spiffy duds?
Well, it is Aloha Wednesday for us, but typically it's Aloha Friday, which is a lot like Casual Friday, where when you go to work, your employer says, you know what, you've worked really hard this week, why don't you dress down and get ready for the weekend.
So today's Wednesday, we're wearing the Hawaiian shirts. Does that mean our weekend starts after the show?
Sadly, no. But we are not talking about our weekend. We are talking about the crew on the International Space Station, and they actually like Aloha Fridays. They put on their Hawaiian shirts and get ready for movie night.
Yesterday was Halloween, and the crew got into the spirit. Ooh. They wore their Halloween costumes. It's little things like this that keep them connected with home.
I have to wonder who is trick-or-treating. Around the International Space Station.
I'll bet they didn't get very many.
No, probably not. But it's not just Hawaiian shirts and costumes that give these connections to home. There are a lot of other things. And one of the important things is music. And we had the opportunity to talk to astronaut Chelle Lindgren about an instrument that he took to the International Space Station.
I'm joined by Chelle Lindgren, who spent 141 days in space and completed two spacewalks. Thanks so much for talking with us today.
Absolute pleasure to be here.
Now, you took something very interesting with you along into space. Can you tell us about that?
You bet. Well, we all have a small allotment of personal items that we're allowed to bring up into space with us. Some people will bring food, clothing, some personal mementos from home. In addition to some of those things, I brought with me a set of bagpipes.
Now, how does the bagpipe play in space compared to on Earth?
The pressure inside the space station is the same as it is on Earth. They play the same way, but it's a pretty difficult instrument to play, and it proved challenging in space as well.
What'd the crew think of it?
You know what, they were amazingly patient with me. I actually went to the farthest part of the space station away from the crew quarters in order to practice. And did that when I had the opportunity to practice. But both Kimia and Scott were very generous and said that they actually liked to hear me practice. For Scott, he actually grew up in New Jersey, and he said it reminded him of home.
Now, was music something that was important to you guys while you were up there?
Absolutely. You know, I think that if music is important to you on Earth, it's doubly important to you on orbit. It's a reminder of home, and there's a lot of opportunities to listen. As we're working over the course of the day, we would typically have some music playing in the modules just to help us pass the time.
Thank you so much for talking with us.
It was an absolute pleasure. Thank you.
I'm now joined by Dr. Jim Picano and Beth Turner. They are actually at the Johnson Space Center in Houston, but they're joining us live via video. Thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us.
Now, you two are not astronauts, but you do have some very interesting jobs. Jim, do you want to tell us a little bit about what you do?
Certainly. Well, Beth and I both work for the Behavioral Health and Performance Group here at NASA. And our job is to enhance the psychological health and well-being of astronauts on orbit. And so my job as a psychologist is to assist from the behavioral health perspective with the selection, training, and then on-flight support, psychological support of astronauts, or on the on-orbit psychological support of astronauts.
Beth, do you want to tell us a little bit about what you do? Your job is slightly different.
Yes, ma'am. So my title is Psychological Support Coordinator, and I keep the astronauts connected to their families via video conferences they may have on the weekends typically. We also send up music, like you talked about earlier, and TV shows, movies, maybe personal videos from the families as well to keep that bond that the astronauts have with their families.
The astronauts have to exercise a lot, and Jimmy, you were telling us a little bit about how important music was during that time. You want to elaborate on that?
Well, certainly. The astronauts exercise for about 2 hours every day, and that's important for them because that helps them keep their bone health and muscle health while in space because of the effects of microgravity on bone and muscle. And in order to help that time pass more quickly, astronauts will typically listen to music while they're exercising. As Chell said, it sort of helps, you know, with the time passing. Plus, we know that music helps to motivate people when they're exercising, just by seeing that when we go to the gym, and like all of you probably know, that you feel a little bit better when you're listening to music and a little bit more energized.
I know that I could not exercise for 45 minutes without my music playing. Beth, you talked about sending up videos and television shows. How does that happen?
So we will provide them or record them or purchase the TV shows or videos down here, and then we send them up every day, typically late morning, along with the procedures and other data here from the Johnson Space Center on the local area network to the station.
Are you all ready to take a couple of questions?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Okay, let's start with a video question.
Hi, my name is Christian Goodwin and I'm 11 years old. And my question is it possible to build a space station that people could stay there and not come back?
He wants to know if it's possible to build a space station that people would not have to come back to. And I want to know, would you want to build something like that?
Yeah, you know, that's really interesting. I can't imagine psychologically that people would want to go someplace and not come back. You know, we're sort of connected to our families and friends and our lives on Earth. And our astronauts love doing their mission on orbit. And the 6 months in space is a long time, and we're talking about sending folks even longer on exploratory missions, say, to Mars. But I don't know that we're ready to have people live in space forever. I don't think that people would want to not come back home.
We have an audience question next.
Hi, my name is Camila Kubedu, and my question was, do astronauts get scared?
I actually heard Colonel Randy Bresnik answer that question not too long ago, and he said he thinks everybody gets scared at a certain point in their life, and he talked about going out on a spacewalk and seeing the Earth 250 miles below you, going 17,500 miles an hour, and when it goes dark, it's just pitch black, he said, and it's kind of nervous. He said, but how you overcome, courage is not the absence of fear, it's how you overcome it, and so working the procedures that they've learned through training and all of that helps them overcome that fear.
We have an online question next. Do the astronauts have individual iPods?
Yes, ma'am, they do. We send up an iPod with them typically with all their personal music that they want. It comes in handy when they want to play music in the station, maybe while they're house cleaning on Saturday, or if they have a two-day rendezvous and it takes 2 days to get to the station, those iPods come in handy to pass the time.
We talked to our friends at Washington International School about some things they might miss, and they sent us a list of things they thought they would miss, and we made a word cloud. Let's go to Marty and see what they had to say.
Thanks, Beth. I've got my friends here, and what would you miss if you went on a long trip into space?
I think I'll miss my family, my friends. I'll miss definitely playing soccer with gravity.
How about you?
As Terrence said, I'd certainly miss my family and my friends. I'd also miss like more unique things like the food we eat here.
Okay, so you guys submitted a whole bunch of words of things that you would miss in space. And in a word cloud, the more times a word shows up, the larger the word is. So take a look at the word cloud that your class created. What are some things that you noticed there?
Wi-Fi and memes.
Yeah, you notice, I mean, family's obviously a big one, and I think all astronauts miss their family when they're up there, but Wi-Fi and memes are very important to middle schoolers, and we were kind of surprised that Netflix, Chipotle, and cats all made the list. There were some kind of surprising things there, but it also shows you what's important to a middle school student. You might be surprised by some of the things that the astronauts miss while they're in space. We got a chance to talk to astronaut Reid Weissman, and he missed something that you might not have thought of. I'm here with astronaut Reid Weissman. He spent 165 days in space. Thank you so much for talking with us today.
You bet.
What's the most challenging thing about being in space for that long?
You miss your family, of course. You miss home. The thing that really struck me as odd is towards the end of my mission, I missed sitting down. I missed laying down. It's an interesting thing to think about. But you know, at the end of a long day, when you just sit in that chair, sit on your couch, and you're like, I'm relaxed. Gravity just, it triggers this relaxation sensor in your body. Well, for 165 days, we never laid down. We never got to sit down. And I really miss it. You miss pizza, you miss carbonated beverages, but in the end, sitting down.
Now, are there challenges the astronauts that go to Mars are going to face that are different from just a long-duration space flight on the space station?
I absolutely think there are. And you can start looking at the psychological challenge of, every day when I'm on the space station, I'm only 250 miles up. I have a rescue vehicle. I can climb in. I can get home. When you fire those engines and you get out of Earth's gravity and you're heading to Mars, there's no return. So your rocket ship has to be really reliable. Your spacecraft better be reliable. You're going to watch the Earth get really small in your window as you're going away from it. I think it'll be great because you'll have Mars getting bigger, and that'll be a neat kind of human perspective to look at. So reliability of your spacecraft, you got to worry about. You got to worry about safe return. You got to worry about the psychological impact. So there's a lot. Oh, and there's radiation out there that, you know, we're fairly protected from on the space station, and you're going to worry about that. But you know what? All these challenges, we know them. We know how to answer them, and we're working through the space station to solve all these problems, and we're actually getting pretty close.
Now I'm joined by Dr. Jennifer Lavasser, who is a curator in our space history department. Thank you so much for joining us.
No problem.
Sitting, I would have never thought of.
Me neither.
Well, from the very beginning of the space program, astronauts have been keeping a connection with Earth through photography. Do you want to tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, sure. Ever since astronauts could carry cameras to space, they wanted to share their experience with us. And so all the way back to some of the first spacewalks on Gemini 4 in 1965, we got to see exactly what they were seeing, which was the first time we'd see a person in space, a person with the backdrop of Earth. And this really made a huge change to the way we understood what spaceflight is all about. And then moving on through the Apollo program and all of the visits to the moon, we got to see what they were going through. And on Apollo 11, astronaut Michael Collins took this really great photograph, which is called The Loneliest Man. And the reason it's called The Loneliest Man is because he's the only person in all of human history, including at the moment the photo was taken and forever, that was in this photograph. He's the guy behind the camera, and there's nothing else behind him. All you see is the spacecraft with the two astronauts that are going to go to the moon and all of the people back on Earth. And so it really changed our perspective about things. It gave people a really big picture idea of what things were like. And what really changed our perspective was this photograph from Apollo 17. This is the first time we really see the entire Earth. It's often called the blue marble. And it starts to change our ideas about how to protect our Earth and our environment. And astronauts are the ones that bring us that message. And they feel a really important role in that. And so getting to look at Earth and talk about what they see is a huge part of how they connect with us during and after their flights.
Now, astronauts on the International Space Station are still taking photos, and it's not film anymore. They can snap a photo and share it with all of us on social media.
Absolutely. They're taking digital photographs, so they can take millions of photographs all the time, just like you and I can on our smartphones or on our digital cameras. And they have access to the internet, so they can download all those pictures from their camera. Those can be put up onto social media, so we're seeing what they're seeing almost in real time. And so it gives them a connection to us that they're sharing these things, and they're participating in the same social movements that we all see here on Earth. They're always taking selfies too. And so this is one of the very first space selfies taken. This is taken by a Japanese astronaut on the space station during one of his spacewalks and is often called sort of the ultimate selfie. Not many people get to take a selfie in space, and so that makes this thing pretty special. But he got to share it with all of us just by putting it out on social media.
And some astronauts will take photographs while they're in space or of the planet, and this inspires them to create other artwork on Earth. And two of them, I'm thinking, why don't you tell us a little bit about Alan Bean and Nicole Stott?
So Alan Bean was an Apollo astronaut. He went to the moon on Apollo 12, and he had this idea that he was going to take a picture of him and the commander, Pete Conrad, during their spacewalk on the moon. And unfortunately, they lost the timer that they had stashed away to be able to take that photograph. They got to take ones of each other. But when he came back to Earth, he said, I've got to figure this out. I got to do something with this. And he had been an artist throughout his life. And so he actually created this painting and many, many other paintings inspired by his experience. And so instead of getting to show all of that, all of us that experience that the two of them had, he painted it instead. So it's kind of an impressionistic way of thinking about his experience. He actually uses tools in his paintings. So some of those textures you see in the painting are actually space tools that he's pressed into the paint. And the other astronaut is in this picture with Alan Bean. That's Alan Bean on the left. And the artistic astronaut, Nicole Stott, she's a shuttle and station astronaut. And so she took photographs. And you can see her photograph and her painting in the image there. So she was taking photographs and actually interpreting them, much like Alan Bean did, while she was even on the space station. And so she's using different materials and integrating them into her paintings to really show how she's inspired by space and her own work there.
And we've showed our artists that are here a photograph taken from space, and they're interpreting it in their own way.
Thanks, Beth. Yeah, I've got some great artists over here, and they've got some great works of art going on. And what we started with this morning when they got here was we showed them this image. This was a picture taken by astronaut Jeff Williams. And what are you guys, what's going on in this picture? Let's start with this one. What's going on there?
Well, in this picture, you mostly see a space shuttle, and you can sort of see the silhouette of Earth and the sun behind it, and the space shuttle gives a clear focal point.
Okay. What did you guys notice in this picture?
Well, I noticed that the space shuttle is dark and the background is light.
Okay. Did you guys like the colors that are in this picture?
Yeah, they're cool.
I think they're really cool. And so this picture has actually inspired a lot of different things. It's the cover picture of a book by one of our curators, Dr. Valerie Neal, here at the museum. It's actually hanging here in the Moving Beyond Earth gallery, and it inspired the artistic astronaut, Nicole Stott, and she actually painted a pendant with this painting as the inspiration for that. And now you guys have been using this image as some inspiration for your artworks. Let's start over here and tell us about your artwork.
So for ours, we decided to do, because you see there's a space shuttle that's black in color. So we decided to do like planets in color and the background in black. And then down here you see we have a space shuttle with its fire and it's black inside color.
Okay, how about you guys? What do you got going here?
So our drawing was influenced by the photo you saw. And the title, it's called Spaceflight in the Shuttle Era and Beyond. And we took that word beyond and we used it to show what's beyond the Earth and what we don't know yet.
So I drew like the stars, and in one of them I drew kind of like a constellation saying home, because what we were learning today most about was the psychology of like what happens when you're out in space and what you miss the most. Also, that like shark looking thing is a shuttle. So we thought that could be the Challenger if it had made it out, because it would have accomplished a lot of things.
Wow, you guys have put a lot of thought into this artwork. These are incredible. We'll be taking pictures of these and sending those out on social media later. You guys have done a great job. You've got a few more minutes to keep working on this. So Beth, let's head it back over to you.
One of the things that I always associate with home is comfort food, and food is very important to the astronauts as well. Jim and Beth, do you want to tell us a little bit about food and the importance of that on the International Space Station?
Yes, food on the International Space Station. Well, food is important in our lives in general because it provides more than just fuel for our bodies. You know, fuel, as you say, provides a certain amount of comfort at times for us, and we also attach other social things to our food and to our meals. And it's not different for astronauts on the station. They, of course, lack some of the variety that we have, although the food there is quite good, we're told, but they lack some of the variety that we have here on access to here on Earth. So they have a lot more of the same kind of foods that they eat over and over again. And that sometimes can be a little bit monotonous for them. So we like to get involved in helping them out with some foods that they like and some foods that bring them happiness and comfort.
Beth, they send food up to them. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am. So we pre-flight meet with them and find out what kind of food they like and what reminds them of home, whether it's, you know, beef jerky or candy bars or cookies or peanut butter cups, you know, just whatever they like. And so we send that up to them so that they can, it's a little bit of home.
One of the things that we understand that the Italian astronauts like is espresso. And recently we got a chance to talk to Samantha Cristoforetti, who is an ESA astronaut. And she told us an interesting story about the espresso machine that's on the International Space Station.
I am here with Samantha Cristoforetti, who is an Italian astronaut. So you had the first espresso in space. And being an Italian astronaut, how important is it to have those sort of comfort foods with you on the International Space Station?
Well, the espresso was huge for me. It kind of came towards the end of the mission, and it was huge not only for the espresso itself, which was pretty good, but just the, you know, the whole story of this espresso machine. I had followed it from the very beginning. I had tried to encourage it. I think I had helped out a little bit, and I know the team who made it happen in such a quick way. I mean, they were amazing, and so it was wonderful to actually have it up there and be able to taste the first espresso in space. And of course, I had a lot of great food from Italy. I try to eat healthy. I think that's really important. I had from Italy, I had stuff like olive oil, dark chocolate, you know, the one that's not full of sugar and fat, but is actually good for you. I had a snack bar that was made of grains and nuts and spirulina and goji berries and all kinds of fruits, so which is very tasty but also very good for me.
Well, let's take a poll. How many of you out here in the audience have been away from your family for 2 days? How about a week? How about 6 months? Well, recently we talked to astronaut Randy Bresnik, who is on the International Space Station, and he talked a little bit to us about missing his family.
That's tough, because I have a 7-year-old daughter and an 11-year-old son, you know, second grade, and just started middle school, sixth grade. And obviously my wife, who I've been married to for 14 years now, and I miss them a lot. You know, it is hard. But just like, you know, military people who serve overseas, or people in the State Department, or, you know, places where, you know, we're not able to be at home, you find ways. You know, you communicate via email is really a nice way to stay in touch, sending pictures back and forth. And then fortunately nowadays we have an internet protocol phone that I can just hop on. Anytime we have satellite coverage, I can call down to Earth, anywhere on Earth, any phone number, and talk to people. And the communication is so good after it leaves the space station, goes to satellites, back down to the ground, and then through this phone system, that it sounds like I am down on the Earth using a cell phone. And so that's a really good way. And then for those of us up here, we also have weekly conferences with video, kind of like Skype, that we can actually see our families and talk to them. So that really makes it seem not so far away. So it's really, really good in that regard.
Shall we take some questions?
Absolutely.
Let's start with the video question.
How far out is the International Space Station?
Jennifer, how far is the International Space Station?
Well, it's about 250 miles up, which is about the same distance between, if you were to drive, between New York and Washington, D.C.
So this is pretty far up. Let's take an audience question next.
Hi, my name is Isadora, and can you bring pets into space?
Can you bring pets into space? I think that's a good question for our folks out at Johnson. Can you bring pets into space?
So no, they have some animals up there, mice and frogs, but they don't get to take them out and play with them.
We also have an online question. What is the food astronauts most request while in space? Johnson, do you have a question, an answer for us about that?
Oh, goodness.
So we get a lot of folks asking our folks like Beth to send up some spices like sriracha sauce and things like that to help spicing up the food a little bit, because sometimes there's some change to the taste and the taste buds, and so they like to give it a little bit of spice. We get that a lot, requests for that.
Let's take another audience question.
Hi, my name's Camila, and my question is, what are the effects of isolation in space?
I'm going to throw that one back out to Johnson. What are the effects of isolation in space?
It's all you.
Beth is throwing that at me. Both Beths are throwing that here. Well, certainly the feeling of being away from your friends and family can make that isolation feel, you know, pretty intense, because you're not having access to all the information that we have on a daily basis to keep connected to the world, to world events. And so that can bring with it a sense of feeling alone and isolated. And so really the effects of that could be, you know, pretty serious. And so our jobs are to minimize those effects, to help astronauts feel more connected to their families and friends in the events here back on Earth. And that's a large part of what Beth does when she sends up the things that help them and stay connected with their families and to our culture and to the happenings here on Earth.
Well, Jennifer mentioned that the International Space Station is about 250 miles above the Earth, but we're going much further. And later this month, STEM in 30 will look at the spaceship that will take us there.
Check this out. This is the Apollo Boilerplate Command Module. This never went into space. It was used by the astronauts for training. The astronauts of Apollo 11, the first mission to send astronauts to the surface of the moon, trained in this module. NASA's working on the next vehicle to get astronauts into space, called Orion, but it won't have to stop at the moon. It can keep going on to Mars. If you want to learn more about Orion, be sure to check out STEM in 30.
That's all the time we have for today. I want to thank our friends out at Johnson Space Center, Jim and Beth, for joining us, and Jennifer for being with us here. I also want to thank our sponsor, NASA.
A huge thanks to our student artists and photojournalists. Yeah. These artworks are amazing. We're going to have you guys sign all of these before you go. Nice work. Be sure to check out Twitter and Facebook to see some of those images here in the next couple of days.
Thanks for watching.
One, two, three, four.